Well, good afternoon. Glad to have you with us here. Pastor Lewis here. I'm going to talk to you about a very important topic, one that seems to, you know, sometimes when I hear people speak on this topic, there's a confusion that goes on of what is actually taking place in Scripture. This is something I've studied out for now almost 30 years because it was taught so much at my church growing up. And when I say growing up, I'm talking in the last, I didn't come to the Lord until almost 25. So I do want to share this with you and be able to explain some things because I'm going to put this on some different feeds here as we went live. But I want to be able to share with you some differences in the Antichrist and the beast, because these are actually two different topics, believe it or not. And they're often confused by many believers in their application. So what I want to be able to do is to clarify those two terms. What is the beast? What is the Antichrist for you? So you have a clear understanding of what is going on with that. And I think that's really important. I think people are looking for an antichrist. They're looking for some man to rise up. So I want to clarify this and go through some scripture. Now, antichrist, believe it or not, I'm going to say a really, really difficult thing for a lot of people here, is not the topic of the book of Revelation. Matter of fact, Antichrist isn't mentioned in the topic, in the book at all. Antichrist is only in four scriptures in the Bible, and it's all written by the book of John, or by the Apostle John. Now, I want you to understand something about John. John, James, Andrew, and Peter, as found in the book, I do believe it is of Mark 13, are the four that are actually given access to hear Jesus teach about Matthew 24, Mark 13, and Luke 21, about the destruction of the temple. And they ask him a very specific question, which is a pretty dynamic question for them. And that is, tell us when the destruction of the temple will be. And the reason this is a very dynamic question for them, and maybe not so much for those of us in America or not in Jerusalem or not Jews, not Jewish heritage, the reason this was such a great, great question for them is because their whole life is centered around the temple. And we sometimes just overlook that. It's in Mark 13:3, it says, now as they sat in the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, tell us when these things will be and what will be the sign when these things are about to be fulfilled. Now, the reason I want to say that is because John is dealing with something in the topic of the Antichrist. Now, so let's first look at number one, that the Antichrist is an individual. It's a spirit. But it is an individual, it's anyone who walks away from Jesus and denies that he came in the flesh. Listen, we're going to go through four scriptures, all we got to go through for this, and is an antichrist, is embodying an antichrist spirit. 1 John, we're going to go through 1 John 2:18, 22, 1 John 4:3, and 2 John 7. So there's your four scriptures that it's mentioned in. So it says, little children, it is the last hour. Now I'm going to hit on that in a second. It is the last hour. As you have heard of the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. Now that's a really puzzling thing, except if you read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, when he's dealing with these things, Jesus said, many will come in my name and say that I'm him. And then he goes into many will, when he says, many will come in my name, he's not saying many will come professing that I am, that they are the Christ. Many are going to come and say they're believers, and they're going to deceive many. That's literally what Jesus is saying there. He's not saying many are going to come and say that they are Jesus. Many are going to come in the name of Jesus, in my name. They're going to come, and they're going to deceive many. And that's really important. And the last hour, I believe, is related to Matthew, Mark, and Luke dealing with the destruction of the temple. Now, I don't believe that when we're talking about the last days, that the last days have lasted 2,000 years. I don't believe that. I believe we don't know when Jesus is coming back. As an apostle, I'm just going to flat out say this to you. Nobody knows when the Lord is coming. We are to occupy, advance, expand, proclaim, and deliver people until he comes. We are to bring heaven to earth. That is our assignment. It's not my assignment to try to tell you when he's coming back, because that is just too difficult to do. I don't know. I believe Jesus might know. I believe when Jesus said no one knows except the Father, I believe, you know, Jesus is God now. Yeah, you have to understand now, as the Son of God is one thing, but he's up there in heaven. Jesus knows everything, sees everything. He is back into that. Even though he's always man, he now is still glorified in the place that he is deity. He knows everything. He can operate in his deity now. Like, okay, and that's what he's doing. And in his deity, he knows everything. Okay, there's nothing hidden from him and all that. So I believe he does know, just like the Spirit knows. The Spirit's job is to help us, equip us, to make that connection to the Father through the Son and be prepared and make a way for him. All right, now, he says, who is a liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist who denies the Father and the Son. In 1 John 4:3, and every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. Now, I want you to see that it's a spirit. I want you to see it's a spirit that's in the world. It operates. And anyone who leaves the body and goes out and now confesses that Jesus is not, they go, you know, they just change their mind. They decide to deny Jesus. By the way, in Hebrews 6, it tells us that such cannot be renewed again. I know I'm not talking about someone who never believes. I'm talking about someone who believed, operated in the gift of the Spirit, tasted of it, operated it, and then goes out and denies Jesus ever came in the flesh. It says you can't renew him again. So don't get hung up on that. But it's Jesus even said, hey, you deny me before men, I deny you before the Father and before the angels. I think sometimes we really do struggle with some of those statements, because he is so loving to us at all the time, right? He is absolutely loving and delightful and merciful and gracious and a provider and a deliverer and a healer, that we can't ever think that God goes, no, but God does. Romans 1 talks about it as well. So it's hard for us to grasp sometimes, because we don't want to ever look at the severity of God, even though Paul commands us to behold the goodness and the severity of God. And there's a reason for that, because it is important that me and you both understand that it is that God is good all the time, but there is this place where God does have to judge, because in his goodness he has to judge. If God doesn't judge, God is not good. I got to say that to you again. If God does not judge, God is not good. He's not good. Why? Because he has to judge certain things as it is necessary for him. Okay, so the Antichrist is a spirit. We've got one more scripture to read, 2 John 7. For many deceivers have gone out into the world who do not confess Jesus Christ is coming in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an Antichrist. Okay, so I want you to see it's a person. It's not someone who's going to take over the world, okay? Even though that spirit might operate in people and take over the world. But we're kind of looking for this Antichrist person, someone who personifies himself. It's not what it's talking about in Antichrist. All right. Now, let's get on to the beast, because the beast is different than the Antichrist. The beast is spoken of in the book of Revelation, okay? And, you know, everyone knows the famous passage, the mark of the beast. Don't take the mark of the beast. And I want you to listen to this. This is just Revelation 19:9. Here's some scriptures on the beast. I saw the beast, the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. Okay. Let's go another one. God has put into their hearts to fulfill his purpose, to be of one mind and to give their kingdom to the beast until the words of God are fulfilled. I want you to see that. Now, I want to say this to you about the beast. I want you to understand the difference between the beast and an antichrist. The beast doesn't talk about denying Jesus. So it could actually even be someone who says, yeah, Jesus came in the flesh and still be part of the beast. Now, but there's scripture's going to tell us that the problem we have in sometimes we don't really sometimes keep the Bible as our guide. We have a lot of people who kind of repeat things that they hear. But I'm going to tell you kind of frankly, and I'm going to do it Louisly. I'm going to do it as Louis. I'm going to tell you that the beast is mentioned in Scripture and other prophecy. And it gives us clarity to what the beast is, not who the beast is. And that's important because the beast is not a who, but a what. And I'm going to put it this way. The beast is an empire, not a person. And there was many king successions, but it's still the beast. Now, because I want to show you that this is all in the book of Daniel. And I want you to understand this. And then this might help you in your studies of eschatology. And I think we have to have an eschatology of hope. I just did one. It's going to become available. It's on the Kingdom Transformation School, but it's going to become available as its own product. I think that people need an eschatology of hope, not one of the, oh my God. I think as many Christians were shocked at the winning of Donald Trump as the Democrats were. And I think the reason was that they were shocked is because they felt that the end was coming and we needed an antichrist. We needed, you know, somebody who would take America such a dark area that, you know, we could finally have Jesus come back. And that's just, you know, to be honest with you, really sad to me. In Daniel, I'm just going to skip through these real quick to you. Daniel chapter 2, Daniel's going to get a vision. And he gets the vision because Nebuchadnezzar is going to go out there and kill all the soothsayers and prophets and wise men because he had a troubling dream. And Nebuchadnezzar can't figure out his dream. He can't understand it. He remembers his dream, but he can't understand it. And he doesn't trust his own wise men and all them because he knows they'll just prophesy something, but he's troubled by the dream. And in his troubling of the dream, he knows he just doesn't need their, like, you know, Nebuchadnezzar, long live, you know, and it doesn't need that stuff. So he doesn't want that. He wants honest to goodness, truth. And he knows that the only way to ensure that he's going to get that is if he actually sits there and says, hey, tell you what, if you got the interpretation, you'll have the dream. And what I love about Daniel's heart in serving here is Daniel doesn't sit there and go, yeah, kill him. You know what Daniel said? Daniel, through his actions, saves the unrighteous from Nebuchadnezzar, the false prophets and all that. And he says, stop, don't kill them all. You know, we'll get the dream. We'll get this for the king. And he does. And I just want you to go to Daniel 2:44 if you have time. If you don't, go later on and look at this. Watch the video again. It says, in the days of the kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom. Oh, let me go back farther. I got to go back farther. Verse 36. This is the dream. I should go back farther. Okay. Verse 24. Therefore, it went to Arioch, and the king had appointed to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and thus said to him, do not destroy the wise men of Babylon. Take me before the king, and I will tell the king the interpretation. Then Arioch quickly brought Daniel before the king and said thus to him, I have found a man of the captives of Judah who will make known to the king the interpretation. The king answered and said to Daniel, whose name was Belshazzar, are you able to make known to me the dream which I have seen and its interpretation? And so he sits there and he says, Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret which the king has demanded, the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, and the soothsayers cannot declare to the king. But there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets, and he has made known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what will be done in the latter days. Your dream and the visions in your head of bed were these. As for you, O king, thoughts came to your mind while you were on your bed about what would come to pass after this, and he will reveal secrets as made known to you what will be. But as for me, this secret has not been revealed to me because I have more wisdom than anyone living, but for the sakes of who know the interpretation of the king, and that you may know the thoughts of your heart. I love that. See, he's saying, Nebuchadnezzar, you're on your bed and you're thinking about the future. And God wants to let you know the thoughts of your heart. It's just stunning because Nebuchadnezzar is a non-believer. And it's just stunning, isn't it? I want you to know, I mean, that's the wonderful God we serve. All right. And he says, you, O king, were watching and behold a great image. The great image whose splendor was excellent stood before you, and its form was awesome. The image head was of fine gold, its chest of arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. If you watch, while a stone was cut out without hands, which struck the image in its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. The iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were crushed together, became like chaff in the summer threshing floors. The wind carried them away so that no trace of them was found. And the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream. Now, we will tell you the interpretation of it before the king. You, O king, are the king of kings. I love this statement because God's not threatened by this. You know, and when we think sometimes God's threatened, he's not. You are the king of kings, for the God of heaven has given you a kingdom, a power, a strength, and a glory. And wherever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field, the birds of the heaven, he has given them into your hand and has made you ruler over them all. You are the head of gold. But after you shall rise another kingdom inferior to yours, then another, a third kingdom of bronze, which shall rule over all the earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron, inasmuch as iron breaks in pieces and shatters everything. And like iron that crushes, that the kingdom will break in pieces and crush all others. Whereas you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, the kingdom shall be divided, yet the strength of the iron shall be in it, just as you saw the iron mixed with the ceramic clay. And as for the toes of the feet, you were partly iron and partly clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly fragile. As you saw the iron mixed in ceramic clay, they will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, just as the iron does not mix with the clay. And in these days of these kings, listen to this, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to another people. It shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Inasmuch as you saw the stone which was cut out without hands, cut out of the mountain without hands, and in that it broke in pieces, the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will come to pass after this. The dream is certain, and the interpretation is sure. Now, let's button this up real quick, just this point. I want you to notice the iron. I want you to notice the 10 toes. I want you to know these are four kingdoms, okay? Each one got successfully, or more successful, but also more ruthless, okay? Until we get to the four kingdoms, or four empires, are Babylon, Medes, Persia, Greek, and Roman Empire. Every scholar believes that. Every scholar confesses that. There's no... absolutely no disagreement on that from anything I've read. Anyone thinks this is something different. The stone cup without hands is Jesus. He comes and sets up a kingdom in the days of these kings. So now we have to think, when did Jesus come? He came during the Roman Empire. He said, his message was, the kingdom of heaven is here. He came to set up a kingdom. Okay? I want you to see that because that's important. When I was starting out in Christian faith, I was told that Jesus would come back and set up a kingdom, but that's not what it says. He came preaching a kingdom. I can't find one place where Jesus said, I'm taking the kingdom back. Okay, you go, well, how come everyone doesn't believe? Hey, we have a president right now that not everyone wants to abide by. Don't think that's strange? Okay, that's been throughout history. All right, so I want you to see that what has happened here. Okay, I want you to see that there's iron, tin. I want you to see these because we're going to see these again. Turn to Daniel chapter 7 because this is where Daniel starts talking about the beast. And it's the vision of the four beasts, or we can sit there and just really just roughly say this, the four empires. The fours are following Daniel through this thing, and we're going to see the fourth beast is similar to the other beast. Okay, the ten toes, the iron, and all that. We're going to see this. It's got similarities because it's the same image. God sometimes likes to use different images for us to get understanding. All right. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and a vision on the head while on his bed. Then he wrote down the dream, telling the main facts. Daniel spoke, saying, I saw in my vision by night, behold, four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea. And the four great beasts came up from the sea, each different from the other. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings, and watched till its wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the earth and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and the man's heart was given to it. Now, that's interesting. Because if you remember, Nebuchadnezzar grew like feathers on himself and talons, and then it was given to him to stand back up like a man again. Very interesting. All right. You could see this if you read Daniel, and you'll see the imagery. and suddenly another beast, a second like a bear, it was raised up on one side and had three ribs in its mouth between its teeth. And they said thus to us, arise, devour much flesh. Here comes Medes Persia, came in, did all that. After this, I saw a night vision, and behold, look, behold, there was another, like a leopard, which on its back was four wings of a bird. The beast also had four heads, and dominion was given to it. Now, you know, most of our Western culture is dictated by the Greek Empire, not the Roman Empire. Literally, the Greek Empire still influences a lot of Western culture, and it's been gone for 2 millenniums and more, and it's still influencing the Western culture, okay? And then after this, I saw in a night vision, behold, a fourth beast, dreadful, terrible, exceedingly strong. It had huge iron teeth. It was devouring, breaking in pieces, and trampling the residue of its feet. Remember the feet, okay? Remember the fourth empire, kingdom, in his first vision, his feet, it's trampling them. It was different from all the other beasts that were before it. It had 10 horns. So there's the 10 toes. Now it's got 10 horns. It was considering the horns, and there was another horn, a little one. And it's going to give you some intricacies about this kingdom or about this empire. Now, what I want you to see in here is that the beast is an empire a thing. Now, I'm really going to say something that's really going to, you know, might get everyone to just like throw stones, but it's the Roman Empire and it's no longer there. Why? We are told that this fourth kingdom and beast, that when Jesus came, he crushed it. And by the way, he did. It does not mean, let me tell you this, it does not mean that the enemies of the kingdom will not try to create another kingdom. But you have to understand that what Daniel's vision is about the timing of the coming of the Savior to Israel. I want you to understand that. Daniel's not prophesying about the end of the world. I'm sorry, we're just going to have to make it through here. Daniel is not prophesying about the end of the world. Daniel is prophesying about the coming of the Messiah. Because look, I watched till thrones were put in its place and the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from him before him, and 1,000,000 ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated, and the books were opened. By the way, this is the book of Daniel. And this is the book of Revelation. This is in the book of Revelation, what he's saying right here, okay? What I want you to see is that the book of Revelation, when it talks about the beast, isn't talking about the Antichrist. It's talking about an empire that was existing in John's time. The Antichrist can be an individual who goes out and says, Jesus never came. There's no Father. There's no Son. There's no Savior. That's an Antichrist spirit. That can be in the lowliest. It doesn't have to be anyone great. It could just be anyone. That's the spirit that's deceiving. Okay, it's a deceiving spirit and denies that Jesus came. The beast is an empire that wants to devour. And you could sit there and make the argument of the caliphate, Islam, trying to be that beast that devours. You can make that argument, but it's not the beast in Daniel. It's just another beast. It's just another empire that's trying to rise up and deny Jesus. You really should do some studying on, there's a video on my regular page, Facebook page. If you scroll down, the 1400 years of Islam, and you'll see why this all came about. Why do I want to say this to you? Because I want to give you a hope in eschatology. I understand that we are victorious people. We are a conquering people. We are a free people, liberating force. We are God's nation that delivers others. And so I want you to have no fear. I don't want you to worry. I don't want you to have any of that. I want you to stay strong in the Lord and not get so concerned. That's the Antichrist. That's the Antichrist. No, no, no. Don't do that. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Keep your eyes on our assignment. Keep doing what you're called to do and keep preaching boldly. And I'm telling you, if you keep doing those things and you keep doing that, then the greatness of your God will walk through you and he'll meet you. You know, what's great is I'm meeting people every day. I purposely have got myself out there to meet people and pray for people. And it's so much fun. I just felt I was getting stagnant and I wasn't doing enough of that. And I had to put myself in a position to meet people. And I did that. And now I just get to pray for people all the time. And it's fun to me. It's fun. All right. So let me just pray with you. I might do another. If you have any questions, comment. Let me know. Okay. Comment on it. And we can answer some of those questions maybe for you, because that's what I'm here for. I love you. God bless you, Father. I thank you for your people. I thank you that we are full of your spirit and full of hope and full of life and power and strength and might in you. I thank you. I bless them, Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus. May the Holy Spirit rest on us. Amen and amen, amen. God bless you. Have a great day. We will talk to you later. Bye-bye.